You're watching KTN Prime, and we thank you for staying with us.
And the Devolution Secretary, Anne Waiguru, is with us in studio. She will be speaking to Yvonne Mukwara on a myriad of issues. Yvonne.
Ben Linder, thank you very much. We are joined by Cabinet Secretary, Devolution and Planning, Anne Waiguru. Thank you for joining us this evening. Let's start off from where Sharon's story has left off, with a bit of resistance to the relaunch of the NYS and some of those allegations of militarization of the youth in the country. Some say this is what happened in 1989, and that's why, you know, that's what happened then, and it's a repeat of it now. Tell us your response to some of these claims.
Thank you for having me. On the question about the initial resistance, that again, I've always said, even including in other programs, you would expect that when you're initiating a program, any new initiative in any part of the country at this time, especially with a new devolved structure of government. But we have since resolved those issues, and as you're aware, we've been progressing fairly well in Kibera and have made good progress in not just cleaning, but ensuring that we are empowering the youth in Kibera through training. On the issue of the fear on militarizing the NYS, I think I need to clarify that we do not have, as a government, any official report from the NIS saying that they are concerned. So that was picked up by the media somewhere. We've tried to get the report. We can't find it. NIS, National Intelligence Service, does not have that official report. Having said that, anyone who would be concerned would probably just be concerned because they're not very clear of what the program entails. The paramilitary training that is going on in NYS has been carried out since 1964. It's exactly the same training that previously university graduates used to go through. So it does not involve the use of arms or ammunition at all. What it does, it inculcates a culture of discipline and perseverance and resilience and hard work and servitude. That is what is called paramilitary training. So it's not military in the fact that people are regimented and that they work in certain groups and they have leaders and they wear a uniform. That's it. But there's no fear whatsoever that is legitimate with regard to the militarization.
All right, so it's been relaunched this year. How would you say it's markedly different, the NYS that we see now, from the one that was there in the 80s?
A lot of thinking has gone to the restructuring of the NYS. There's a new five-point plan now, which wasn't there before. Previously, there would be training, and even in the training, even the paramilitary training was quite different from the one that we're doing now. At that time, physical fitness was mostly one of the things that they looked into. They tried to build character, but it was not realigned, for example, to Chapter 6 of the Constitution and our values as outlined in our constitution. So what we've done is completely reprogrammed the paramilitary training to re-socialize the youth towards the value system that we have defined ourselves as Kenyans, as the values that we would want to be defined by. Integrity, for example.
So it's more value-based system
it's
now,
it's a value-based paramilitary training.
All right.
Then we have a huge component on national service, which is what you see us doing in Kibera right now. You'll see us across the country with various other programs. It wasn't there in that kind of format before. We've expanded the national service. It's expected that everybody who goes through paramilitary training will also go through the national service. Again, for the same reasons why we take people through paramilitary training before then they go for their vocational training.
I'd like us to move to another issue. A deadline is looming very soon. By the end of this month, you hope to have completed the restructuring program, or rather assessing and the rationalization program within the civil service. Let's talk about the purpose of that, the end game with that. Is it just about counting people, okay, saying so-and-so really exists and so is a ghost worker and so does not exist? Let's talk about that process and what happens after the 31st of October.
Okay. As we've always said, this is an initiative of both levels of government. It's as a result of an agreement at the summit level where the national government and the county governments agreed that we need to look at our human resource capacities, mostly as a result of the devolution and the fact that we devolved quite a number of functions to the counties. So the main objective is actually to make an assessment of how many people we are, what skills that we hold in the public service, and where we are placed. And the reason we're doing that is so that we can be able to plan better and allocate resources appropriately. Mm-hmm. That's really the reason why we're doing it. Having said that, we cannot say that there hasn't been concerns, because our initial check of the our systems showed that we had some integrity issues. And the issues of ghost workers had come. Uh-huh. There was also issues of double registration. And so this exercise is also intended to ensure that our system is efficient and accurate.
So we intend to weed out those who shouldn't be there, or who essentially do not exist. Yeah. So what happens after the 31st, after the exercise has closed? What then? Because is it only just about weeding out ghost workers?
I've just responded and said that it's about capacities. And it's about knowing where the human resource capacity in government is placed, what skills we have in the government, what qualifications, academic qualifications, levels of experience, how many we really are, as a matter of fact.
Okay, I guess to sort of clarify my question is, will people then be moved around based on capacities? Is there going to be redeployment from one department to another based on the findings?
Yes, you would expect that, because if you remember at the beginning of this year, we got into an agreement with the county government to freeze recruitment until we finish the capacity, so that if they wanted any human resource, they would request from the national government and then we'd be able to place them. That way we do not continue increasing our wage bill. We also intend to clean the database, because if people don't show up, that means they do not exist. And so we cannot authenticate whether they have really bona fide civil servants. And so we'll remove that from the payroll, and that saves us a lot of money. So
is there any point of recourse for those who may not show up but truly exist within the payroll for one reason or another? What happens to those who don't? Will you strike them off the payroll? Are they sacked? I know you've talked about this before, but just tell us what happens to those people who do not turn up.
We've asked all public servants to show up. The ones who exist have shown up. As I said, we've registered up over 94% or so. We are expecting to see a couple more before the end of the week. And we have said it very clearly that if you do not show up for registration, you will be deemed as not being in existence, because we know there are those that don't exist. So if, for example, we see you in the database and we don't see you physically, that means you really don't exist. And so you will be deemed to be a ghost worker.
Any form of recourse for others who may exist, but for one reason or another, not able to show up?
Able or will not show up? Because there's two different categories of people. There are those people who are out of the country, for example, on long-term study leave. Mm-hmm. And there are those who are probably indisposed because they are unwell.
Yes.
And those, again, your human resource department would have the details for that. So if they don't show up, they're in a special category. When they show up, they will be registered and they are known. But the ones who do not come, for whatever reason, either they are not legitimately recruited in government, or they do not exist, they will not receive their salary as of November.
Okay, all right. Yeah. Let's move to devolution. Government has emphasized its support for devolution, and of course, your ministry being the custodian of that, at least at the national level. How would you rate devolution, specifically because we see all these wrangles within county assemblies, governors are being impeached, county speakers are being impeached, and it gives Kenyans the impression that there's a lot of wrangling and not much service delivery. In your opinion, as the head of the ministry that is in charge of devolution, do you feel politics might be hampering service delivery at the county level?
I think to some extent, I would say in some counties, yes. I wouldn't say that for all counties, because as you know, we have 47 counties. Those that have had very serious issues are a small number. Mm-hmm. And we've always said in any transition, you would expect those kind of push and pull. Yeah, you would expect some certain level of disagreement because it's a new reform initiative. We've never been here before. Everybody is learning anew what their roles are. Everybody's looking for their own space. So you'd expect those wrangles. It's unfortunate that we have spent a lot of energy, especially in those counties where there's wrangling, a lot of energy that would have been channeled positively in service delivery. And we are urging all those who are involved to speedily resolve those issues so that we do not jeopardize service delivery to the Kenyan people.
What would you say is one of the successes of devolution from where you stand? What are some of the services that have been successfully devolved and you're seeing some sort of progress in that area?
I would say that most of the services that have been devolved have been successfully devolved. Mm-hmm. We've had agriculture, for example, fisheries, those services are running and pretty well. We've had health devolved, it's running pretty well in most counties. There was a time there was an issue. I think one of the issues I always pose when it comes to health is we need to ask ourselves, in many of these counties where we say that the health structures don't look good, what were they like before devolution? Because it's possible that they were not any better, it's just that their lens was not there because we were not seeing and the places were a bit far flung. And when we've looked at the counties that have devolved, have effectively devolved the health functions, many of the counties are doing much better than the function, much better than they were doing before.
Right. The Doctors Union is asking for a health commission that would be able to take a look at human resource issues, salaries, deployment, promotions, that sort of thing. What's your take on that? Should a health commission be formed? Because they say they're essentially not opposed to devolution, just wanting the health commission in place.
I will take the advice of the constitutional experts. They've been duly advised by the constitution implementation of the Commission on the Implementation of the Constitution that it is not constitutional to form a health service commission because there already exists a public service commission that encompasses all public servants. If you form a health service commission, what stops you from forming an agricultural service commission, mm-hmm. and then a fisheries service commission, okay. and then all these other commissions?
Yes. Okay.
So this was deliberated before the constitution was enacted, uh-huh. and it was agreed that the public service commission will suffice okay. for the health sector.
Right.
And so we hold that view until
okay. So it'll handle otherwise. Yeah, all of those who work under yeah. the civil service. Let's move to matters of the wage bill. We're seeing increased demands from teachers, nurses, doctors. But we remember during that wage bill conference, the president promised to take a pay cut. Could you update us on the progress of that? We know legislation was supposed to be in place. How far has that gone in terms of gazetting it? And is the president now earning 20% less? For that matter, are you also taking a pay cut at this moment?
I would want to say, because I know he's a man of his word, and because we know that in government we do what we have committed to do, that he took the pay cut. I can't say because I don't look at his paycheck, but I believe that he has, and this has been an issue in the public. I took a pay cut immediately. It's just that recently we were informed that we should have written letters before we took the pay cut. Mm-hmm. But the pay cuts were actually affected by our HR officers immediately the announcement was done, because this is managed by our human resource officers. It's okay. not even actually managed at your right. individual level. You'll just notice that there has been a pay cut. Yes, we've taken our pay cuts.
So you've also taken a
yes,
pay cut?
Yes.
So you also earn 10% less?
Yes.
Okay, all right. Let's move to Waiguru the person. You've heard, I'm sure, a lot of descriptions about yourself. You take no prisoners in your execution of your duties. You are tough. You are no nonsense. What's your response when you hear a lot of these descriptions of yourself in this way?
I don't have a response to that. I think I have always said that when it comes to service delivery and standards, I don't compromise. So if you're one of those who are mediocre, you will actually find me a bit unrelenting in that way. Having said that, I think you cannot judge yourself. I think everybody has a differing opinion. There are those who will say that, but there are those who know you differently. It depends on in what context that you know me. But when it comes to work, I actually don't mind being known as efficient, if you ask me. Okay. And uncompromising where standards are concerned. I think it's a good thing. I wish all of us had the same reputation. Mm-hmm. I would be concerned if it was a question on integrity, uh-huh. for example.
Right, yeah. Yes. And another description, I guess you remind very many people of John Michuki, the late minister. And Mutahi Nguni has said you have the spirit of Michuki. Others say you're a Martha Karua in the making. Would you consider a career in politics?
No.
5, 10 years?
Never.
Many point to your homecoming as one that was grooming you for politics.
No, not at all. I just went for a Thanksgiving service. In fact, when we started planning for it, I thought I'd have 300 people. So I was actually surprised that it generated that amount of interest. I have absolutely no interest in politics. I don't think that will ever change. Okay. I'm a technocrat, has always been, mm-hmm. and I will finish at technocrat level.
Okay, all right, okay, we'll leave it at that. Thank you very much for your time. We've been speaking to Cabinet Secretary Devolution and Planning, Anne Waiguru, on the NYS Devolution Wage Bill and a host of issues. And we look forward to seeing your comments of this conversation. I hand it back to Ben and Linda.